Well, welcome to Southwest Church. Merry Christmas.
Here comes Santa Claus, here comes Santa Claus, right down Santa Claus Lane. Help us out, clap a little. And a blizzard and a rain is pulling, pulling on the rain. Come on, help us out.
Bells are ringing, children are singing, all is merry and bright. Good. So hang your stocking and say your prayers, cause Santa Claus goes tonight.
Oh, here comes Santa Claus, here comes Santa Claus, right down Santa Claus Lane. He's got a bag that's filled with toys for the boys and girls to get. Hear those sleigh bells jingle and jingle, oh, what a beautiful sight. So jump and fat and cover your head, cause Santa Claus goes tonight.
Oh, here comes Santa Claus, here comes Santa Claus, right down Santa Claus Lane.
He doesn't care if you're rich or poor, he loves you just the same.
Santa Claus knows we're just like children, that makes everything right. So fill your hearts with a Christmas cheer, cause Santa Claus goes tonight.
I lost ya.
Here comes Santa Claus, here comes Santa Claus, right down Santa Claus Lane. Here come around with a chime ring out, it's Christmas time again. Peace on earth will come to hold it. Let's give thanks to the Lord above, cause Santa Claus goes tonight.
Oh, here comes Santa Claus, here comes Santa Claus, right down Santa Claus Lane.
Big banana blizzard and all of these reindeer pulling on the rain.
Bells are ringing, children are singing, holy is merry and bright.
Hang your stockings and say your prayers, cause Santa Claus goes tonight.
Hang your stockings and say your prayers, cause Santa goes tonight. Woo!
Good job.
Oh, you better.
Oops, I wasn't even in the right place.
Watch out, you better not cry, better not fight, I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. He's making a list, checking it twice, gonna find out who's naughty and nice. Santa Claus is coming to town. He sees you when you're sleeping, he knows when you're awake. He knows if you've been bad or good. So be good for goodness sake. Oh, you better watch out. You better not cry. Better not pout. I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. With little tin horns, little toy drums, rooty toot toots and rummy dum dums. Santa Claus is coming to town. Curly-haired dolls, cuddle and coo, elephant boats and kitty cars too. Santa Claus is coming to town. He sees you when you're sleeping, he knows when you're awake, knows if you've been bad or good. So be good for goodness sake. Oh, you better watch out. You better not cry. Better not pout. I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. Santa Claus is coming to town. Santa Claus is coming to down.
Yeah. And he's bringing tamales.
Dashing through the snow in a one-horse open sleigh. Oh, the fields we go, laughing all the bells on bobtails ring, making spirits rise. What fun it is to ride and sing a sleighing song tonight. Oh, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh.
Are you ready? Dashing through the snow. You know the song, right? Here we go.
Dashing through the snow in a one-horse open sleigh. Oh, the fields we go, laughing all the ha, 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 bells of bobtails ring, making spirits bright. What fun it is to ride and sing a sleighing song tonight. Oh, jingle bells, jingle bells.
What?
Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Hey, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. You know Dasher and Dancer and Prancer and Vixen. You know Comet and Cupid and Donner and Blitzen. But do you recall the most famous reindeer of all? Rudolph the red-nosed reindeer had a very shiny nose. And if you ever saw it, you would even say it goes. All of the other reindeer used to laugh and call him names. They never let poor Rudolph join in any reindeer games. Then one foggy Christmas Eve, Santa came to say, Rudolph, with your nose all right, won't you get my sleigh tonight? Then all the reindeer loved him as they shouted out with glee, Rudolph the red-nosed reindeer, you'll go down in history. For Rudolph the red-nosed reindeer, you go down in history.
I don't know if any of these songs are in the Baptist hymnal, but we're celebrating Christmas. We're celebrating the time of Jesus' birth. Yeah. Even kids kind of know the Christmas story, right?
Once upon a time, baby Jesus was born. Mary. Mrs. Jesus? Mary?
Mary.
Who was Mary's husband?
Adam. Mike. God. Joseph.
Joseph.
Why did they go to Bethlehem? How did they go?
A camel. They walked. They had to ride on horses for days. The fairy came down, and then they flied. And then the fairy flied.
Why did they stay in a stable?
He got there, and he said, do we have a home? And he said, that's the only place.
And the homekeeper said, there's no rooms left unless you don't care if you sleep where the sheep and the cows live in.
And they taked it and it was all stinky. And do you know what kind of animals they had? A cow, lamb, sheep, a horse, two donkeys,
goat, pigs. And then when Mary was sleeping, she had the baby Jesus. And when the cows awoke, then the baby was born and laying in the manger.
And you know what? Jesus turned out to be their own child. Away in the manger, there was no blanket, only this hay. I thought I can sing.
What was the baby wearing?
A blanket.
Just clothes.
My coat. A gold circle on his head. A hat and white clothes.
How did the shepherds
There were
find
shepherds
the
watching sheep, and then a bright star in the sky.
Stars!
Went to them.
And other planets?
And it was as bright as day.
The angel said, follow the star.
The star that shines above him is the sign for the only Jesus.
Who came to see Jesus?
A fairy? Yeah, an angel on top of the roof.
Noah. Amy, good.
The wise men.
What gifts did they bring?
A blanket.
They bought him food, water, and like stuff he could play with.
A bottle and some toys. Baby food?
Rattle. They brought him gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
Happy birthday, Jesus.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jesus.
Happy birthday to you.
Merry
That was cute, wasn't it? Even kids kind of know the Christmas story. The people in Jesus' day didn't recognize him, didn't know who he was. Mary and Joseph barely understood what was going on.
Once upon a time, in a foreign land, wise men saw a star and set out across the sand. Songs of praise to sing, they traveled day and night. Precious gifts to bring, they were guided by the light. They chased a brand new star, ever toward the west, across the mountains far. But when it came to rest, they scarce believed their eyes. It comes so many miles, the miracle they prized was nothing but a child, nothing but a child could wash those tears away. Oh God, oh weary world, into the light of day, nothing but a child held their razor vines. So once again we all can be children for a while. Now all around the world, in every land, town, every day is heard a precious little sound, and every mother kind and every father proud looks down in awe.
child, but warms those hills away. Oh, God, a weary world into the light of day. Nothing but a child could help them raise those miles. So once again we all can be children for a while. Nothing but a child could help them raise those miles. Children for a while.
Pretty. Well, meet Joe and Mary.
Meet Joe. He likes this girl named Mary. Meet Mary. Mary was picturing her future with Joe when out of nowhere, an angel tells her that she has been chosen to bear God's son. Things aren't going according to plan. Joe is engaged to the Virgin Mary, who is pregnant. Joe plans to divorce Mary, but an angel appears. Joe is told he should still marry Mary. The child is from God. His name will be Jesus. Meet Caesar Augustus. He issues a decree for a census to be taken of the Roman world. Back in Nazareth, Mary is almost due, and Joe has to make plans for an 80-mile trip to Bethlehem because of Caesar's census. Bethlehem is booked solid. Mary goes into labor, and the only room Joe can find is a dirty, run-down stable. Meet the shepherds. They were outside Bethlehem when an angel of the Lord appeared and said, "I bring you good news for all people. Today a Savior has been born. He is Christ the Lord." Meet the Magi. They're from far away. They saw a star and followed the star, which led them to Jesus. Meet Jesus, the one who was prophesied, the one who will save his people from their sins. Emmanuel, God with us.
Pretty simple story, huh? Kids kind of know it. We kind of remember it. But who really understands it? I mean, I don't. You guys pay me lots of money to know Bible stuff. And it's kind of hard to understand God, right? Nobody understands God. Nobody understands his ways. His ways are above our ways. His thoughts are above our thoughts. But the Bible says that just at the right time, when God chose to bring to fruition all of his promises to come to us, to come for us, to forgive us, to change us, to save us, he chose to do it through this little baby. Luke chapter 1, verse 26. Dr. Luke tells a story like this. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, now this is Mary's cousin, Elizabeth, right? And in the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee. He sent the angel Gabriel to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, who was a descendant of King David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel said, "Don't be afraid, Mary." Why did angels always say that? Every time you find angels appearing, it freaked people out. I think I'd be a little freaked out. Angels showed up. I don't know what they look like. Sometimes they look like dudes. They just look like guys. Sometimes they look like they were wearing lightning, shining apparel. Sometimes they look incredibly vicious, ferocious. On one night, the Bible says one angel of God killed 186,000 enemy warriors. Angels are powerful. But sometimes angels just showed up and they look like just people. Nothing out of the ordinary, nothing strange. When Gabriel showed up, it was enough to scare Mary, to take her, make her take it back a little bit. "Don't be afraid, Mary. You found favor with God.
You will conceive and give birth to a son. You're to call his name Jesus. Jesus is a common name. Jesse, Joshua, that's Jesus. The name means deliverer, one who saves, but it was a common name. Verse 32, he will be great. He will be called the Son of the Most High. Where Jesus was a common name, Son of the Most High was not a common name. Hey, what are you going to name your kid? I don't know, Frank, Pifi, Beto, Tallulah, Son of the Most High God. You know, that was out of the ordinary. But the angel said, this is not just an ordinary kid. Give him an ordinary name, Jesus, because he'll save his people from their sins. That was a little weird. But to say he'll be known as the Son of the Most High, the Lord will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. Of his kingdom there will never be an end. Verse 34, Mary asked, how will this be, since I am a virgin? The angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come on you, come over you, will overshadow you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of the Most High, the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. The reason, one of the main reasons that Gabe said this to Mary was because this was kind of weird. Mary was just a kid. These were arranged marriages.
Mary could have been 13, 14, 15, maybe 16 years old.
She's just a baby herself. She was able to say, how am I going to have a baby? I've never been with a man. And the angel said, God's going to take care of it. Don't worry. This will be out of the ordinary. And just so that you kind of know that God's already at work in all of this, your cousin Elizabeth, who's never had any kids and is way past childbearing years, she's in her sixth month right now. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. Mary, mark this down. No word from God will ever fail. What did Mary say? You know, let me think about this. What she said, let me pray about it. Let me go run this by my mom. She said, I'm the Lord's servant, Mary answered. May your word be to me fulfilled. And the angel left her. The Bible says that all of this story happened, the Christmas story, and then later the Easter story. The Christmas story is God coming down to us. The Easter story is God's Son giving his life for us. God cared about us, and he showed that because God came to us. God actually came down at Christmas. One night long ago, God took on flesh and he lived among us. He came quietly, he came miraculously, he came humbly, he came willingly. The Lord came to love. The Bible says he came to heal. He didn't come to be served. He came to serve. He came to redeem. He came to renew. He came to save. Who did he come for? The Bible says he came for everyone. He came for you. The bottom line? He came. God came down at Christmas. That's the Christmas story. John said it like this in John chapter 3, verse 16. You know the passage. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but would have everlasting life, eternal life. 17 says, for God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but rather that he might save the world through himself. Verse 18 says, and whoever believes in Jesus, not just believe in him like I believe in the tooth fairy. Well, not really. I still believe in Santa. He's still bringing me presents. I still believe. You know what happens when you quit believing in Santa? They start bringing you underwear. You don't want to get there. Keep believing in Santa.
Believe in the tooth fairy as long as you can. Pretty soon we're going to start losing them again. And whoever believes in him is literally whoever believes on him. Whoever places their faith and trust in him. Whoever rests in him. Whoever believes in Jesus is not condemned. But whoever chooses not to believe, whoever chooses not to trust Jesus, stands condemned already because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is God's plan of salvation. You know God's plan of salvation? It's really not so much a plan as much as it is a man. God's plan of salvation is the man of salvation, Jesus Christ. Jesus chose to be with us. Jesus chose to be like us. Jesus chose to be in us. And I'm telling you, none of this makes any sense. I believe it because it's in the Bible. The fact that Jesus chose to be with us, okay. That he chose to be like us, that he chose to be in us, but that's what the Bible teaches. Look, Jesus chose to be with us. Matthew chapter 3, verse 23, chapter 1, verse 23. The virgin will conceive, will give birth to a son, and they will call him, in addition to Jesus and Son of the Most High God and Son of God, call him Emmanuel. Emmanuel literally means God is with us. Jesus chose to be with us. Now, we heard the Christmas story from the kids a while ago. Most of us kind of know the Christmas story. And really, the truth is, though, it's kind of hard for most of us to really grasp, to really understand that Christmas story. We're probably more like these kids.
One day, a long time ago, a lady named Mary found out that baby Jesus was in her tummy. Joseph and Mary went on a business trip when Mary was about to have the baby. But all the hotels were full, so they had to stay in a barn.
You stay in this barn, Mary.
Okay.
So where were they on their business trip?
Baltimore.
Baltimore.
Meanwhile, in the desert, the two wise men were watching for a very long time.
Wait, two? Are you sure it's two?
Oh, I'm sure. You could tell they were wise because they all had glasses.
The wise men all had glasses. That's how we knew.
Yeah, I know. Those two smart men at Baltimore, and they liked baby Jesus so much, and they bought him a lot of presents, and they bought him gold, Frankenstein, and myrrh.
Gold, Frankenstein, and myrrh.
Frankenstein, you sure?
Yes. And they got even more presents for Mary and Joseph. Nintendo DSi. Silly bears. The Spider-Man came in.
Spider-Man
wasn't there. Yeah, he was. Soon, baby Jesus was tired of playing with Spider-Man, so Mary put him to bed early. Everyone else went to bed because Santa was coming soon.
Yay, Santa!
That's a true story of Christmas.
There you go, that's
a
true story.
A time for giving love and everything. Merry Christmas to all and all good night.
Merry Christmas, everyone!
The truth is, it's kind of hard for... for most of us to really understand the Christmas story. We know the idea is kind of Jesus came, Jesus was born, you know, there's something about a stable and something about a manger and something about donkeys, and he was born in Baltimore, like they said, and the wise guys, we know they were wise men because they all had glasses, and they brought, gold, Frankenstein, and myrrh, you know. Another version is gold and Frankenstein and mermaids. So just depending on who's telling the story, you get a kind of a different slant on it. But the bottom line is Jesus chose to be with us, right? And then the Bible says that Jesus chose to be like us. The writer of Hebrews says it like this. Because God's children are human beings who are made of flesh and blood, the Son of God also became flesh and blood. For only as a human being could he die, and only by dying could he break the power of Satan, who had the power of death. Verse 15. Only in this way, only by God becoming a man, could he as a man live like us. The Bible says be tempted like us, but he never sinned. And in that way, as a man, he was able to break that power of sin over us. I don't understand it. That's just what the Bible says. Verse 15, only in this way could he set free all who have lived their lives as slaves to the fear of dying. 16, so we also know that the Son of God did not come to help angels.
He came to help the descendants of Abraham. So first of all, he didn't come to Mexicans. He didn't come to Native Americans. He didn't come to Baptist preachers. First of all, he came to Israel. He came to Jews. And then at some point, he chose to turn to us, to Gentiles, to non-Jews. He loved the world so much. You read in the Old Testament that God chose to bring his forgiveness, his presence, his blessing through the nation of Israel. At some point, Israel said, you know, I don't think we want to associate with those people. We're those people. But when Jesus came, he said, no, my truth, my forgiveness, my blessing for all people. So we also know that the Son did not come to help the angels. Actually, he came first of all to help the descendants of Abraham, the Jews. Therefore, it was necessary for him to be made in every respect just like them, and then ultimately just like us, his brothers and his sisters, that is flesh and blood, so that he could be our merciful and faithful and understanding, another version says, high priest before God. Then he could offer a sacrifice that would take away the sins of all the people. That's us as well. The Bible says that God became a man, and he did that for us. Have you ever looked at the night sky and thought, whoa, there's a lot of stars out there? Some say some 76 trillion stars in the universe. That's a 7 followed by 22 zeros. That's a lot. It would take a pretty big God to create all of those stars. Ironically, this is also the same God that we see on the Christmas cards. A little baby surrounded by shepherds and farm animals. The all-powerful God lying helplessly in a feeding trough, in a manger. Doesn't seem the most fitting place for the creator of the universe, does it? What if the reason God showed up in Baltimore, in Bethlehem so many years ago, was to know you? Sound pretty absurd? Yeah, pretty ridiculous. Why would the God who created the universe want to know us? What could God hope to get out of a relationship with me, with you? To get gifts? He created everything. To be flattered? I like what you've done with the place, God. God already knows. You have only one thing. We have only one thing to offer the Creator God. Yourself. That's one of the mysteries of Christmas. God entered time and space to intersect with us, with your life. He came to know you, to be known by you, to love you, and to be loved by you, to save you. The angel in the Christmas story said it best. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior, the Savior, has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. God became a man. The Bible says he became a human for us. He did that for us. Jesus chose to come to us. He chose to be like us. The Bible says Jesus Christ chose to be in us. Colossians chapter 1, verse 27. God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles, that's us, the glorious riches of this mystery. What mystery is that, Paul? The mystery, Christ in you, which is the hope of glory. Paul said to the church at Galatia, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith, the faith of the Son of God who loved me and he gave himself for me. He said, I'm crucified with Christ and I live, yet not I, but it's Christ who lives in me. Christ takes up residence within us if we let Christ take charge of us. That's up to you. We get to decide whether we want him to be the boss of our lives. It's one thing to go to church once in a while. It's one thing to be kind of religious. It's one thing to celebrate the Christmas story. But it's quite another thing to give Jesus Christ permission, like we're anybody, to tell the creator of heaven and earth, oh, it's okay, you can do that. For us to tell the Lord of glory, you know what, don't do that. Don't do that. Oh, okay, you can do this. How arrogant for me to think that I could tell my creator, okay, you can be my boss. Okay, you can take charge of my life. But that's kind of what he's allowed us to do. He's allowed us the privilege, the dubious honor of saying, Jesus, I like you at arm's length. Thanks. You're the little saint on the steel dashboard in the 57 Chevy. Right? Remember a little plastic Jesus with a magnet on the bottom? You stick him on that steel dashboard, and you want Jesus there if you ever get in a car accident. But on Friday night, Saturday night, you put the little Santito in the glove compartment. I want you there when I need you, but I don't want you bugging me. I don't want you bothering me. I don't want you changing me. But he gives me the honor of saying, Jesus, I want you to take up residence in me. I would love for you to take charge of me. Christ died for us. How tough is it for us to decide to live for him? Pretty tough. It's pretty hard. Maybe it's easy for you. It was hard for me. It's hard for most of the people I've talked to. It's hard to give up, to make an unconditional surrender to Jesus Christ. Becoming a Christian is not just starting to come to church. Becoming a Christian is not turning over a new leaf. Becoming a Christian is not as simple as, you know what, I'm not going to be a bad dude anymore, I'm going to be a good dude. It's not as simple as saying, you know what, I'm going to start reading the Bible, and I'm going to start giving money in church. Shoot, I'll even let him throw me in that horse trough over there. That's all good. The Bible says it's just not good enough. The Bible says that we've all sinned, right, and come short of the glory of God. The Bible says that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, his Son. God gave himself as the first gift of Christmas. Huh? I'm a sinner. The Bible says Jesus is God. He died for my sins. He was buried. And what did he do on the third day? The Bible says he rose from the dead. And now I can trust him. The Bible says I can believe him. If I give my life to him, the Bible says, I don't know. This doesn't make sense to me. I don't know. Except this says that if I give my life to Jesus Christ, if I believe him, not just believe in him, I believe in Abraham Lincoln, I believe in George Washington, I believe in George Washington, I believe in Jesus, but I'm making a distinction between just believing in Jesus. I'm placing my faith and trust in him. I'm believing that if my sins can be forgiven, they'll only be forgiven through Jesus Christ. I'm giving my life to him. Christ died for me. What a small thing for me to decide. I want to live for him. Christmas in a nutshell, Jesus came to us. Have you ever given some terrible gifts? No surprise that God is the ultimate gift giver. Created everything. For Christmas, however, he gave us something special. Something that no one ever expected. It was the greatest gift that he could give us. Himself. The God who formed the heavens and knew you before you were born was now a little baby. Seems weird, seems odd that God's rescue plan for a world in need was a baby. Not to scale. But God's answer to the world's problems has never been stuff, material things, money. Instead of giving us more stuff, he gave us himself. God entered into the very situation he wanted to fix. He gave us his presence, not that kind. He showed up in our neighborhood. He came to us so we could know who the eternal God is and what he's really like. God now had a face. God has a voice. And he walked among us. The miracle of Christmas in a nutshell is this. God showed up. God, the creator of heaven and earth, came to this planet in the form of a baby, a helpless baby, a vulnerable baby. Kind of a weird thought, kind of a weird plan, that I could give my life to him because he chose to give his life for me. That you could turn to Jesus Christ, and without becoming a Baptist, without me throwing you in the hot tub, without turning over a new leaf, without buying a three-piece suit, wearing a necktie, and a big old family King James Bible, you could give your life to Jesus Christ and have your sins forgiven. You could be born from above, the Bible says. You could be born again. You could actually be saved. Would you pray with me? Would you bow your heads with me and just come before the Lord? You bow your head and just realize that God loves you. He gave his life for you. And he wants nothing more than for you to give your life to him right now. Would you do that with me? Maybe you've already given your life to Jesus Christ. Maybe we can just kind of nail it down and pray a prayer like this. Lord Jesus, I believe you. I trust you. I need you. I want you to be the boss of my life. Please forgive me. Change me any way you choose. Please take up residence within me. And Jesus, please take charge of me. Thank you for loving me first. Thank you that I can love you back. Thank you for letting me be a part of your family. Thank you, Jesus, that Christmas is the story of you giving yourself to me. And this Christmas, I'm giving myself to you. In your name I pray. Amen. What a strange way to save the world. What a strange idea.
Strange way to save the world. sure it must have been a surprise. And well, this road had taken him. Cause never been a million lives would he have dreamed of Bethlehem. And standing at the manger, he saw with his own eyes the message from the angel come to life. And Joseph said, why me? I'm just a simple man of trade. At this stable filled with me, why her? She's just an ordinary girl. Now I'm not one to second guess what angels have to say. This is such a strange way to say. Jesus had come as he deserved, there would have been no Bethlehem, no lowly shepherds at his birth. The chosen knew the reason love had to reach so far. As he held the Savior in his arms, he must have thought, why me? I'm just a simple man of trade. At this stable filled with hay, why her? She's just an ordinary girl. Now I'm not one to second guess what angels have to say. This is such a strange way. Such a strange way. This is such a strange way to say the word. Oh, 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 oh. This is such a strange way to say.
The Bible says the Word, Jesus, was made flesh and dwelt among us. He threw up a tent in our neighborhood. The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory. The Bible says because of who Jesus is and what He did for us, we can be saved. The Bible says because of who Jesus is and what He's done for us, we can follow Him in baptism. We can be soaked. The Bible says it because of who Jesus is and what He's done for us, we can be saved, have our sins forgiven. We can follow the Lord in obedience in baptism and be soaked. And the Bible says because of who Jesus is and what He's done for us, we can be serious about living our life for Jesus Christ. Call His name Jesus. Call Him Emmanuel, which means God with us.
unto us a child is born, to us a son is given. And the government will be upon his shoulders. And he will be called Jesus, Emmanuel, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God. He is the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. He's Jesus Christ, the Son of God, our Savior, your Savior. The Bible says the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. Let's stand together, we'll pray, shall we? Let's stand together, our heads bowed, our eyes closed. Lord Jesus, thank you for this time. Thank you for Christmas. Thank you that we can get together with family, with friends. Maybe we'll just get off by ourselves. But I'm grateful, Lord, that no matter where we spend this holiday, we can spend this time with you. Lord, you gave the very best gift when you gave yourself. And Jesus, I pray that we would follow your example and give our lives back to you. Thank you for everyone who's here. Thank you, God, for being so good to us. Thank you for being with us during the difficult times, for blessing us with the great times. But more than anything, Jesus, we want to thank you again for forgiving our sins. Thank you for forgiving me. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for changing me. Thank you for working in me. Thank you, Lord, for leading me. Thank you for living in me. I love you, Lord. Thank you for loving me first. Thank you that I can celebrate your birthday in honor of you. It's in your name I pray. And everybody said, amen. God bless you guys. Merry Christmas.